Ladies and gentlemen, good evening, and welcome to Church Farm School. We thank you for joining us tonight, and hope you will enjoy our Christmas pageant. This year, we celebrate the 92nd anniversary of our school's Christmas tradition, and our students have worked diligently preparing for your arrival. The pageant will be presented to you in two parts. The first part will be read to you by our head of school, Reverend Ned Sherrill. The story has to do with a boy named Pedro and his little brother. They have a secret plan to go to the city on Christmas Eve to see the celebration in the Greek cathedral. Their journey is interrupted when they come across an old woman in the snow. The second part of our pageant will be presented by our students in pantomime. Various characters march up the aisle of the Greek cathedral, each to present his or her Christmas gift, hopes of hearing the legendary Chimes. The last gift will be presented by Pedro's little brother. We invite you to take part in our pageant tonight by reciting the Creed, the Lord's Prayer, and singing the carols, thus becoming participants of the pageant and sharing in its glory.
There was once, in a faraway country, where few people have ever traveled, a wonderful church. It stood on a high hill in the midst of a great city. And every Sunday, as well as on sacred days like Christmas, thousands of people climbed the hill to its great archways, looking like lines of ants all moving in the same direction. When you came to the building itself, you found stone columns and dark passages and a grand entrance leading to the main room of the church. Altogether, no such church as this was ever seen before, especially when it was lighted up for some festival and crowded with people young and old. But the strangest thing about the whole building was the wonderful chimes of bells. Now, all the people knew that at the top of the tower was a chime of Christmas bells. They had hung there ever since the church had been built and were the most beautiful bells in the world. Some thought it was because a great musician had cast them and arranged them in their place. Others said it was because of the great height, which reached up where the air was clearest and purest. However that might be, no one who had ever heard the chimes denied that they were the sweetest in the world. Some described them as sounding like angels far up in the sky, others as sounding like strange wind singing through the trees. It was the custom on Christmas Eve for all the people to bring to the church their offerings to the Christ child. And when the greatest and best offering was laid on the altar, there used to come sounding through the music of the choir the Christmas chimes far up in the tower. Some said that the wind rang them, and others that they were so high that the angels could set them swinging. But for many long years, they had never been heard. It was said that the people had been growing less careful of their gifts for the Christ child, and that no offering was brought great enough to deserve the music of the chimes. Every Christmas Eve, the rich people still crowd into the altar, each one trying to bring some better gift than any other, without giving anything that he wanted for himself. And the church was crowded with those who thought that perhaps the wonderful bells might be heard again. But although the service was splendid and the offerings plenty, only the roar of the wind could be heard far up in the stone tower. Now, a number of miles from the city, in a little country village, where nothing could be seen of the great church but glimpses of the tower when the weather was fine, lived a boy named Pedro and his little brother. They knew very little about the Christmas chimes, but they had heard of the service in the church on Christmas Eve and had a secret plan which they had often talked over when by themselves, to go to see the beautiful celebration. "Nobody can guess, little brother," Pedro said, "all the fine things there are to see and hear. And I have even heard it said that the Christ child sometime comes down to bless the service. What if we could see him?" The day before Christmas was bitterly cold, with a few lonely snowflakes flying in the air, and a hard white crust on the ground. Sure enough, Pedro and little brother were able to slip quietly away early in the afternoon, and although the walking was hard in the frosty air, before nightfall, they had trudged so far, hand in hand, that they saw the lights of the big city just ahead of them. Indeed, they were about to enter one of the great gates in the wall that surrounded it, when they saw something dark on the snow near their path, and stepped aside to look at it. It was a poor woman who had fallen just outside the city, too sick and tired to get in where she might have found shelter. The soft snow made of a drift a sort of pillow for her, and she would soon be so sound asleep in the wintry air that no one could ever waken her again. All this Pedro saw in a moment, and he knelt down beside her and tried to rouse her, even tugging at her arm a little, as though he would have tried to carry her away. He turned her face toward him so that he could run some snow on it. And when he had looked at her silently a moment, he stood up again and said, "It's no use, little brother. You will have to go on alone." "Alone," cried little brother, "and you not see the Christmas festival?" "No," said Pedro, and he could not keep back a bit of a choking sound in his throat. "See this poor woman? Her face looks like the Madonna in the chapel window, and she will freeze to death if nobody cares for her. Everyone has gone to the church now, but when you come back, you can bring someone to help her. I will rub her to keep her from freezing, and perhaps get her to eat the bun that is left in my pocket." "But I cannot bear to leave you and go on alone," said little brother. "Both of us need not miss the service," said Pedro, "and it had better be I than you. You can easily find your way to the church, and you must see and hear everything twice, little brother, once for you and once for me. I am sure the Christ child must know how I should love to come with you and worship him. And oh, if you get a chance, little brother, to slip up to the altar without getting in anyone's way, take this little silver piece of mine and lay it down for my offering when no one is looking. Do not forget where you have left me, and forgive me for not going with you." In this way, he hurried little brother off to the city and winked hard to keep back the tears as he heard the crunching footsteps sounding in the twilight. It was pretty hard to lose the magic and wonder of the Christmas celebration that had been planning for so long, and spend the time instead in that lonely place in the snow.
The great church was a wonderful place that night. Everyone said that it had never looked so bright and beautiful before. When the organ played and the thousands of people sang, the walls shook with the sound, and little Pedro, away outside the city wall, felt the earth tremble around him. We sing together hymn 83.
Thank you.
We recite together the articles of our faith in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. O God, who makest us glad with the yearly remembrance of the birth of thine only Son, Jesus Christ, grant that as we joyfully receive him for our Redeemer, so we may with sure confidence behold him when he shall come to be our Judge, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Ghost, one God, world without end. Amen. O God, we pray thee to send thy blessing on this school, and grant, with the help of thy Holy Spirit, we may strive with one heart, one mind, to make it more and more pleasing unto thee, for the honor and glory of thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. In the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Ghost, be with us all evermore. Amen. Please be seated. At the close of the service came the procession, with the offerings to be laid on the altar. Rich men and great men marched proudly up, to lay down their gifts to the Christ child. Great nobleman and his wife marched haughtily up the aisle, bearing caskets of wonderful jewels to lay at the feet of the Christ child. Surely they feel, for such gifts as theirs, the chimes will ring. Then comes the rich man, his slaves staggering behind him under the weight of a great chest of gold. A king's ransom, which might have brought comfort to many hungering, suffering souls. Next, an old man, an author, carrying in his arms a large folio. This book has been the work of his lifetime. He will lay it on the altar as his gift to the infant Christ. A beautiful but vain girl follows him, fingering lovingly a lustrous string of pearls which has adorned her beauty. To her, these are more valuable than all else. Thank you. Then comes a merchant, rich from merchandise bought and sold. His servant walks behind him, arms full of silks from far-off China and Japan. A splendid gift, the merchant feels. Holds high his mighty sword, which he has wielded so bravely through wars and crusades in the name of God. To him, his sword is dearer than gold or precious jewels. And then, together, down the aisle of the great cathedral, come a musician and an artist. The musician's hands rest lovingly upon his lute, his dearest possession. The artist holds to him a canvas, his last and greatest work, on which he has lavished time and thought. It is Mary and the Christ Child. Are they parting ungrudgingly with these their treasures? Thank you. and now the sweet young girl comes slowly up the aisle, her arms full of flowers, as pure as her thoughts. She raises the flowers to her lips. She would give to the infant Christ that which she herself loves so well. From over the seas comes a Moor. In his hands he carries a vial filled with a rare perfume distilled from many fields of roses which bloom in his native land. Each drop of this perfume is priceless and brings happiness to him who smells it. Very slowly comes a miser, hugging tightly his beloved dad, Silver. He hesitates. Perhaps, after all, it is not necessary for him to take this gift. Surely not the whole bag. That would be foolhardy. One coin might be sufficient to make the chimes ring for him. two travelers from the far north return now to bring into the Christ child the promise of great wealth, which they have sought and now found in new lands beyond the boundaries of their homeland. A husband and his wife come happily up the aisle, bearing gifts of golden wine and purple grapes, planted and nourished and gathered by their own hands. The finest and best of all, they have brought to lay at the feet of the Christ child. A craftsman and two tradesmen come now. The craftsman holds a magnificent chalice. It is the culmination of a lifetime of skilled work. The tradesmen carry their cherished tools with which they have been labored many long years. Gratefully, they bring their gifts to the Christ child. An old shepherd and a young one, straight from watching their flocks by day and by night upon the hillside, have come to worship and to bring their gifts. The old man, though feeble, carries upon his shoulder a bag of wool. The young shepherd holds tenderly in his arms a little new lamb, just born, a baby lamb, to lay at the feet of the baby Christ. Last of all, proudly walks in the king of the country, and beside him his lovely queen. He has been a good king, and has reigned with justice and with mercy. His people love him, and the king is proud of being the king, and his crown, all set with precious stones, is his greatest possession. Any doubt that when he lays it upon the altar as his gift, the chimes will ring.
Thank you.
still, only the cold, old wind was heard in the tower, and the people shook their heads, and some of them said, as they had before, that they never really believed the story of the Chimes, and doubted if they ever rang at all. The procession was over, and the choir began the closing hymn. For Pedro's gift, one small coin, and his sacrifice of staying behind in the cold and the dark to care for the sick wayfarer by the roadside, the chimes rang. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, rest and abide with you and all whom you love, this day and forevermore. Chimes band will sing together in 87.
Oh,